topic for today's class is the Victorian novels. And before we move on to the Victorian novels, let us have an overlook of Victorian era, particularly about Queen Victoria, so that we can have a better understanding on the condition in which the novelists have written novels. We all know that Queen Victoria ruled England and Britain and Ireland from 1937 to 1901 for about 63 years and 7 months. And she has the additional title, the Empress of India. She was the first to take up residence in Buckingham Palace. Before that, all the rulers were living at St. James Palace. So she married Prince Albert. We all know that. And she has faced some 8 assassination attempts during her lifetime. And she also had other negative names like the Femine Queen in Ireland, which came after the Great Famine in Ireland from 1845 to 49 due to the potato crop failure. And she has got this name, the Femine Queen. And she was the first queen who celebrated the Golden Jubilee and as the Diamond Jubilee. We see in history the England, particularly in England history, the queens of England are always living more. If you can see Queen Elizabeth I, then Victoria, now Queen Elizabeth II, who doesn't want to die at all. So Victoria ruled the almost a half a century, and the impact of Victoria and the impact of the rule of Victoria has been deliberately seen in the literature also. In history, we see Victorian era is considered to be the golden age of novels. Almost some 60,000 prose works, prose fictions have been published in England alone over the 6 decades of Queen Victoria's reign. This growth of publications and this growth of the writing helped the spread of education among the middle classes. And Queen Victoria came to the throne during world's first industrial revolution. We all know that. The time that characterized by rapid change and development in all fields. The communication method and the railway networks led to a great production and distribution in all fields too. The novelists dominated the literary marketplace during Victoria's reign. And they introduced the 3-volume format books, and this dominant publishing format of the era made the novels more affordable to the growing mass of the new readers. And the novelists like Dickens, Thackeray and George Eliot, and other few novelists, they have serialized their works by publishing their works in a series of installments and made their readers anxious for the next episode. And the Penny Blood, which you may be aware of, the Penny Blood, it was a magazine, was very popular, which issued weekly and chiefly produced the highly sensational stories. The writers, through their works, depict the life as it affected them, and they represented the social reality and wrote social problem novels, adventure tales, and science fiction sometimes, the detective fiction, and even fantasy novel they have written. After the marriage of Victoria with Prince Albert, the situation in writing, particularly situation in arts and science, had an enormous change. And during the industrial development, Prince Albert took active interest in arts and science particularly. He commissioned the Great Exhibition in 1851, the first international exhibition with a view to commemorating industrial and technological progress. The development of science profoundly influenced the literature of Victorian era. The invention of the rotary press machine in 1888 enabled the printing in industries, which made everything cheaper. The single volume yellow books were printed, and the paper bound editions of existing works began to be sold all over England, and that attracted a large audience ever before. And the non-fictional works, from philosophical writings to political essays, made a mark in literature of the period particularly. And following Romanticism, Victorian poets were influenced by the themes of the previous era, and they developed their own distinct style, giving rise to a new age of poetry with a focus on realism, the skepticism, and a sense of responsibility. With the novels and the periodicals and the libraries and the cities of London, in the city of London, became the central point for literature. And the 19th century also witnessed the expansion of British Empire too, and which was unnoticed and unquestioned by many Victorian novelists and writers. So by the end of Victoria's reign, I'm giving this for your understanding how the empire had a great expansion during Victoria's reign. By the end of Victoria's reign, the British Empire has extended over about 1/5 of the Earth's surface. Imagine, in encompassing almost a quarter of total world population. So the legacy left behind Victorian writers were reflected the changes of the period in observing neoclassical and romantic literary tradition. And the Victorian era was highly conscious of its connections to the past, and it also they have shaped the future, and they have paved the way for the creation of literary modernism. The point which you are seeing on screen are the characteristics of Victorian era, obviously the characteristics of Victorian novels. In a way, Victorian literature, we can see there was a mixture of mingling between and overlap between Romanticism and the Victorian literature, and there were so many problems in the age, like poverty, unemployment, the overpopulation, the child laboring, prostitution, corruption. There are so many negative sides in Victorian era. Particularly, if you remember the Indian Mutiny of 1859, it showed that all was not well in colonies. Again, the evolution of science with Darwin's theory on the origin of species, it questioned the beliefs and practices of the age. So many converts have converts in religion, and there were so many questions on religion and religious people, and particularly the Industrial Revolution and the industrialization of the society, and that show the condition of rich get richer and poor get poorer, and that kind of thing. Then poverty was everywhere, and there were so many diseases. The corruption was everywhere, particularly in church. Even corruption was there in the palace and government. So on a whole, it was like London belonged to the rich, and the other parts of England belonged to the middle class and lower class people. And the rules for rich people and rules for poor people, like there was a kind of distinction, that there was a kind of difference in rules. Then since it was the time of the first industrial revolution, the age also saw a demise of rural life as cities rapidly grew and expanded, and there were long and big factories have established. There were very long factory hours for people to work. Also the Crimean War war with Russia, the Great Game, and a political controversy, a political combat between Russia and England over the rule in South Asian countries. Even the Crimean War, I hope you may remember Tennyson's poem, "The Charge of the Light Brigade," which clearly explains the Crimean War. Then when we speak of the Industrial Revolution, It was not just the transition of a new, it was not just the transition of the new manufacturing process in England, but also a very important social movement. We must look at industrial revolution in such a way. And many hand production methods became machinery products, and particularly the invention of paper machine and the application of the steam power to the industrial process of printing that supported a massive expansion of newspaper and pamphlet publishing, which contributed to rising literacy. It actually literally created more literacy among people. It made them literate. So the simpler or the common scientific methods are easily transferred to people from scientist minds. So they started reading all those things, and they started questioning against the monarch even. And the child laboring that existed before Industrial Revolution, but with the increase in population and education, it became more visible in that time. And many children were forced to work in bad conditions for much lower pay than their elders, and which may be recorded, which would have been recorded in Dickens' Oliver Twist even. So the Victorian era made great development in terms of education in a way. New laws were developed to make education compulsory. Even there were child laboring, and there were steps taken for the development of education. But there were gaps between social classes and gender in education. But still, the literacy rate among the population increased. In a way, wealthy parents send their children to fee-paying schools, or they have employed governors for their children to have their formal education. But there were distinctions, there were differences in education between boys and girls. Boys were taught academic and the functional skills and all, but girls were taught sewing and the needlework, like drawing and music they are taught. But the Victorian government provided money for the construction of schools for the poor in a later time. And in 1844, there was an act passed in Parliament requiring children working in factories to be given 6 half-day schools every week, and it made compulsory. And in 1893, there were schools established for deaf and blind. And so these are the two sides of Industrial Revolution. And again, when we speak of the Great Game, it was an intense rival, or it was an a political game between British and Russia, both empires, and they wanted to have their power on Central Asia. And British played a good game in making Russia down in the combat. And this great game ended with the signing of the Pamir Boundary Commission protocols, and the border between Afghanistan and Russia Empire was defined. And if you can remember Rudyard Kipling's Kim, the novel Kim made the term great game popular even. And he has detailedly explained the real game behind Russia and British combat in Central Asia's power. Then again in the Catholics, they have restored their bishoprics in England after many years, and Pope Pius IX was the person who passed a papal bull in 1850 called the Universal Ecclesiastics to recreate the Roman Catholic diocesan hierarchy in England again, and that happened in Queen Victoria's time. Then the penny black was the world's first adhesive postage stamp, which was used in public postal system, and it was introduced in 1840. Photography was introduced. By the end of the 19th century, the individual cameras were produced mainly. Then London sewerage system, the water system in London, it was introduced. Pub was introduced. The electric lights was introduced. So many new things have been introduced during Queen Victoria's time. So people who lived in Victoria's time, they had two sets of mindsets, like, because they have been without industries, and also they practice their life in industries. Before industrial revolution, people lived in communities, and people worked their natural works, and they were being. But after industrial revolution, all set of people were forced to work in industries, particularly the middle class and lower middle class people. They were forced to work in industry. They were a great set of unemployment, and which geared even like which produced much power, pulled the people into poverty. And when people are at home, naturally it happens, the overpopulation, and obviously the child laboring and prostitution, everything happened in Victorian's era. And this would we can see in Victorian novels all these characteristics, and these characteristics usually it is commonly filled in Victorian novels particularly. And when we move on to the Victorian novels, we must start with Charles Dickens, Charles John Huffham Dickens. when you look at Charles Dickens' life, he left school to work in a factory when his father was imprisoned in a debtor's prison, and so he didn't have a proper formal education. His first novel, The Pickwick Papers, that exalts the joys of travel and the fellowship between men, innocence, youthfulness and romance, all these kind of themes were expressed in this. And after Dickens' success with the sketches by Boz, I hope you know the the nickname of Dickens, Boz, right? After his success with the sketches of Boz published in 1836, his publisher Chapman and Hall asked him to supply descriptions to a comic series to be published. That was the source or the background for Pickwick Papers. The main character is Samuel Pickwick, was the president of the Pickwick Club. He and other three friends should make journeys to places remote from London and report their findings to the members of the club, the other members of the club. And this was the story of Pickwick Papers. And this novel beautifully picturizes the entire England during Dickens' time. Not only the condition of London, but almost all the parts of England. The next other novel, Oliver Twist, the subtitle is The Paris Boy's Progress. It was published as a serial from 1837 to 39. And here Dickens satirizes the hypocrisies of his time, like child laboring, the recruitment of child as criminals, the condition of orphans. All these are expressed in Oliver Twist beautifully. And it is also believed that Dickens' own experience as a youth that contributed to this novel, Oliver Twist. Then Nicholas Nickleby, or the other title is The Life and Adventures of Nicholas Nickleby, was a serial from 1838 to 1839. It was published as a serial, and this novel shows the arrogant and also the ignorance of English people, and their no sense of humanity, how people behave with no sense of humanity. In general, Dickens was really great, particularly with this description of industrial setting and towns in his time. He transmitted the atmosphere where criminals and the lower class lived during his time. And his novel Oliver Twist, Hard Times, and even the novel The Christmas Carol, it all concentrated the theme of poverty. It shows how people suffered in poverty, because that was the situation he lived. That was the scenes that he has seen from people. The Great Expectation, the novel, and the autobiographical novel David Copperfield, and A Tale of Two Cities, novels like these, they speak of the tension between social classes, and the hurdles are the problems faced among social classes, the higher class people and the lower middle class particularly. The other novel, The Bleak House, the characters like the lady Deadlock and Joe, and they are the best examples of the extreme high and low of society. They have shown the high and low of society. And And novels like Barnaby Rudge and Nicholas Nickleby, they all show Dickens' understanding of nature and the function of society. So Charles Dickens actually represented the Victorian society to an extent. Even his novels were liked by all kind of set of people, all kind of people. Even Queen Victoria herself had read the novel Old Curiosity Shop. In 1841, she has given this statement that it is very interesting and cleverly written. Dickens' representation or his concentration on the theme of poverty or the tension between social classes, they're all a very good photograph for the people like us who would like to see how Victorian society was. Then the novel Barnaby Rudge, it was a historical novel. The subtitle for the novel is A Tale of the Riots of 80. I shall repeat, the subtitle for Barnaby Rudge was A Tale of the Riots of 80. The other historical novel of Dickens is A Tale of Two Cities, which was set in London and Paris during French Revolution. The other novel, Martin Chuzzlewit, the subtitle for Martin Chuzzlewit is The Life and Adventures of Martin Chuzzlewit. It was a Picard novel. He dedicated this novel to his friend Angela Georgiana. This is a very important point. You must remember this. Martin Chuzzlewit, the subtitle for the novel is The Life and Adventures of Martin Chuzzlewit, a Picasso novel. Dickens dedicated this novel to his friend Angela Georgiana. Then David Copperfield, as we know, it is an autobiographical novel. The full title of David Copperfield is The Personal History, Adventures, Experience and Observation of David Copperfield, the Younger of Blunderstone Rockery. This was the full title. I shall repeat again. David Copperfield's full title is The Personal History, Adventures, Experience and Observation of David Copperfield, the Younger of Blunderstone Rockery. And this was considered to be an autobiography, and there are even movie depictions for this. And The Hard Times, the other novel, the subtitle of Hard Times is For These Times. It is a satire on social and economical condition of the complete Victorian era. Hard Times show the economical situation of people during Victorian era. And the other novel, Great Expectation, which was a Bildungsroman novel, like David Copperfield, that was the most portrayed novel of Dickens. And his last completed novel is Our Mutual Friend. The famous dialogue you must have read from Our Mutual Friend, a famous dialogue of Bella Wilfer, the character from this novel, that is money, 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 and what money can make of life. It's a famous dialogue from this novel, Our Mutual Friend, and it centers around the dialogue money and what money makes of life. So finally, The Mystery of Edwin Drood. It was actually Dickens planned for 12 volumes to be published, but only 6 were published. The 6th volume of The Mystery of Edwin Drood was published in the year 1870 in the month of May. Due to his death, he left. The remaining 6 volumes were unpublished. So the next important novelist in Victorian era is William Makepeace Thackeray. His novels are often called as the novels of sensibility. So Thackeray was one important figure in Victorian time who wrote or who made his novels purposefully with senses. His plots usually revolve around themes like struggle between selfishness, vanity, the instinctive goodness and honesty, and the humility sometimes. And he was the first novelist who introduced the analytical method in the portrayal and development of human characters. His novel Catherine, it was a story, it was serialized in installments. It was serialized in Fraser's Magazine between 1839 and 1840. It is a satire on the society. It was like a crime fiction. Particularly, this novel, Catherine, was a satire on crime fiction, other crime fictions of his time. Then, The Luck of Barry Lyndon, it was a Picasso novel. It is also serialized in Frazer's magazine, later reissued with the title The Memoirs of Barry Lyndon. When The Luck of Barry Lyndon was reissued after the serialization with the name The Memoirs of Barry Lyndon. Then Vanity Fair, which was a very famous novel of William Makepeace Thackeray, and this novel revolves around and during and after the Napoleonic Wars. And Thackeray was the first person who spoke about the Napoleonic Wars in his novel, particularly in Vanity Fair. Then it was a pure satire of early 19th century England. The Napoleonic Wars happened before Victoria's reign, but still, Vanity Fair was the first novel which was like a pure satire on the early 19th century, and it is considered to be the principal founder of Victorian domestic novels, the Vanity Fair. Then Lowell, The Widower, it was written after his first visit to America, and The Men's Wives, Danis Duval, is an unfinished novel. Men's Wife was published in 1852. It was a simple family novel. Lowell, The Widower, was written after his first visit to America. Then come the three important novelists of Victorian era, the Bronte sisters. The first of his Bronte sisters is Charlotte Bronte. All four novels of Charlotte Bronte are regarded as the masterpieces of English literature still. And her characters are powerful, very powerful, and sometimes very clear too. And her poetic descriptions of nature and her deep explored human experiences are really great, which we can see in her novels. She had firmly challenged and criticized the conditions surrounding women marriage, and the marriage commonly, then social class and employment in 19th century. Her first novel is The Professor, but Jane Eyre was first published. Originally published with the title Jane Eyre, an Autobiography. It was a Bildungs Roman novel. This is the first novel to focus on its protagonist's moral and spiritual development through first-person narrative. And before that, no novels were projected with this kind of thing. The Christian morality and social criticism were high in this novel, Jane Eyre. I hope you know the story of Jane Eyre. I don't want to tell the whole story of Jane Eyre. Then Shirley, A Tale, is another important novel, which was a social novel. The title character was given the name that her father had intended to give her son, actually. The beauty is, in the novel, the beauty is, before the publication of this novel, Shirley was a male name. Only after the publication of this novel, Shirley had become a female name. Then the other important novel of Charlotte Bronte is Violet. This is the most portrayed novel of Charlotte Bronte. And the critics say, like, Jane Eyre, the novel is a sharp and a black and white novel, but Violet is colorful. Virginia Woolf had made the statement that Jane Eyre is sharp black and white novel, but Violet is colorful. Then The Professor, which was written first by Charlotte Bronte, but published as a fourth novel. It was published posthumously in 1857 because no publisher liked to publish this novel, The Professor. It was published posthumously, and this novel is based on her experiences in Brussels, where she studied her language and where she had her most of her education. Brussels, it is the name of a place. And this is based on the experiences which she had in Brussels. Then other important thing is Charlotte Bronte. Her pen name is Currer-Bell. Then the other important novelist is Emily Bronte, also called as Elizabeth. She has written only one novel, Wuthering Heights, and she's known for this novel. And I hope most of you have studied this novel, at least in your syllabus you would have had this novel. It is a classic of English literature, and Emily Bronte had actually challenged the Victorian ideas about religion and the Victorian ideas about morality and class struggles, and also the place of women in society, and she has challenged all this, and it explores the class system during the Victorian era with the tragedy of the character Heathcliff and Catherine. She had challenged the class system of Victorian era. In portrayal of love, we can find a similarity with Jane Eyre, but Wuthering Heights stands for its own plan and its own exploration of class system in Victorian society. The third important, the third sisters of Bronte sisters, Annie Bronte, also called as Actonville, who was known for these two novels, Agnes Grey and The Tenant of Wildfell Hall. As her sister Emily Bronte, she also deals with themes like death and grief, and mostly in her novels. Agnes Grey is an autobiographical novel. The events of Annie's own life, and that comes out of that when she was a governess, and that was the novel. The content in the novel Agnes Grey. The cruel treatment of a governess when she was a governess, and also of women who occur throughout the novel. The people who work as governess in the early Victorian period were not dealt very seriously, and they were actually suppressed. So these type of cruel treatment to a governess were expressed in Agnes Grey, and she has also showed the cruelty towards animals in Agnes Grey. Isolation, empathy, the other oppression of her time were all detailing projected in Agnes Grey. The other novel, The Tenant of Wildfell Hall, it is an epistolary novel, framed as a series of letters from a character, Gilbert Markham, to his friend. It is considered to be one of the first feminist novels in history. This was the first Victorian novel which deals the theme of alcoholism. And before that, no Victorian novels dealt the theme of alcoholism. She was the first one who dealt the theme of alcoholism, particularly in The Tenant of Wildfell Hall. And this, she has dealt the domestic violence in this novel. Then the theme of displacement is underlined actually in the title itself. Here in this novel, the character Helen is a tenant, not a owner of Wildfell Hall. Wildfell Hall is a name of a place where the character Helen was born, and she was a tenant, not the owner. So it all expressed the condition of women, particularly, or how women are treated during Victoria's time. So these three writers, Charlotte Bronte, Emily Bronte, and Annie Bronte, they projected the women's condition. And the class systems are the cruelty towards women, they all projected all these themes. Then comes the very important novelist of all time, George Eliot, otherwise Mary Ann Evans, who is famous for most of her novels, Adam Bates, Silas Marner, Romola. All are her famous novels. The most important theme of George Eliot was finding meaning in life. And she was the first person who was giving a kind of psychological inputs through novels. Even D.H. Lawrence says that George Eliot is an innovator. She had innovated the psychological theme that was inbuilt in the novels. So the rise of psychological novels started from George Eliot. She had brought this genre in novels, that actually she has brought the entertainment type of novels into a medium of serious expression of ideas, and she has converted the entertainment novels type to a medium of expression of ideas. Like, so her first novel Adam Bede was a story told to George Eliot by her aunt. Actually, it is a love rectangle story between the characters like Adam, Arthur Donnithorne, Dinah Morris and Hetty. These are the four important characters in Adam Bede. It was a love rectangle story. Actually, the story was told by her aunt to George Eliot. The other novel, The Mill on the Floss, the loss of innocence was the theme of the novel. It deals the lives of two characters, Tom and Maggie, who are siblings, who are growing up at a mill on the river Floss. And these two characters, Tom and Maggie, their psychological conditions during their life, which happened in The Mill on the Floss, it was beautifully described. It was published in three volumes. Then the other important novel, Silas Marner, it projected the whole 19th century. She presented the whole 19th century in this one novel, Silas Marner. It was notable for its strong realism, actually, and its treatment of issues like industrialization, the community and religion, the problem between industrialization or industrializing society. And to speak of the major themes of this novel, Silas Marner, is the influence of pure natural human relationship, the effect of industrialization on English society, and the community, or the struggle between community, when people have had a better understanding on their religion, or when they are being agnostics, they may have questions, or they may have a kind of a negative approach to their religion. So all these themes were beautifully dealt in Silas Marner. And the other novel, Romola, which was a historical novel, appeared in 14 parts, published in Cornhill magazine from 1862 to 1863. It was first published as a book in three volumes in 1863. The setting of this novel, Romola, is a pure contemporary Victorian England of George Eliot. So if you want to know how England society between 1820s to 1880s, you must read Romola. It was a historical novel. Again, the psychological and religious introspection, which usually George Eliot deals with her other novels, can also be found here in Romola. Then Middlemarch, the other novels like Felix Holt, The Radical, and in particular the Middlemarch, it is a slight historical fiction. It projected with the use of with the use of realism, the historical events like Reform Act in 1932 was projected here, and the historical events like the early railway systems and the accession of King William IV, all these type of historical events were all projected here in this novel, The Middlemarch. Her last novel, Daniel Deronda, is a mixture of social satire and moral searching. So as I told you earlier, George Eliot was the first person who made this type of themes in her novel, the moral searching, or the search for oneself life. So here in Daniel Deronda, the last novel, she has depicted the Jews in contrast with other novels like Albatross, and she has given a good understanding on Jews to the English people with her novel Daniel Deronda. So I missed one important novelist in my slides. Benjamin Disraeli was the Prime Minister during Victoria's reign, was famous for his Endymion, romance, but depicted the political conditions in England during 19th century. I really missed out this novelist. Then the other important and favorite writer Thomas Hardy. He was a Victorian realist, he was called as, and he was a Victorian realist in tradition of Charles Eliot, like. And most of his characters, most of the characters of Thomas Hardy suffer and struggle against passions and the social circumstances. And many of his novels are set in a fictional region called Wessex. You must be aware of all these novels. I think you would have read a few novels of Thomas Hardy at least. So being a Victorian realist, Thomas Hardy examines the social constraints on the lives of people living in Victorian England. And critics say that he criticizes the beliefs, especially those that relating to marriage, education and religion, which is very common in his novels. His first novel, The Poor Man and the Lady, was unpublished actually. And he had given the manuscripts to many publishers, but it was not accepted. And one of his close friends, George Meredith, advised Thomas Hardy that the manuscript will be politically controversial. So accepting the advice of his friend George Meredith, he dropped the plan of publishing his first novel, The Poor Man and the Lady. And his second novel, the next novel actually, The Desperate Remedies, which was published in 1871, was the first of his Wessex novels. As I told you, most of his novels were set in a fictional background, fictional region called Wessex. And Desperate Remedies was the first novel of his Wessex novels. It was published anonymously with the other novel, Under the Greenwood Tree. Far From the Madding Crowd, which was also appeared anonymously as a monthly serial in Cornell magazine. Return of the Native, which was most favorite novels for many, that was presented in 12 monthly installments from January to December in 1878. And those novels dealt the theme of the Victorian society, particularly like the relationship problems, or the education and the religious setup. Then the other novels like The Trumpet Major, was the only historical novel of Thomas Hardy, and that was set during the Napoleonic Wars. So Thomas Hardy was also has also joined in the writers who wrote about the Napoleonic Wars, which happened in the beginning of 19th century. Then The Tess of the Abergavenny, the other title is The Pure Woman, faithfully presented, which was published in a single volume in 1892. The final novel of Thomas Hardy was The Well Beloved. The other title is A Sketch of a Temperament. It was again serialized in 1892 and published as book in 1897 after some 5 years. So most of the novels of Thomas Hardy were the depictions of Victorian society. The coal mines, how the coal mines were there in Victorian time, or how the industrial development, the industrial implement changed the life of people, or how it affected the life of people. All these were seen in the novels of Thomas Hardy. Then the other writer is Elizabeth Gaskell. Gaskell has detailedly shown the contrast of industrial North and industrial South. In a way, Gaskell can be seen with Thomas Hardy when Thomas Hardy shows one condition of Victorian society. Elizabeth Gaskell would show the contrast of both sides, the contrast of industrial North and industrial South. And she has shown the roles of the workplaces in her novels, and then the problems of the masters on men, how they treat their men, how masters treat their men. There were no slavery during Victoria's reign. Slavery was abolished in 1833. But still, the impact of slavery was still there. In the novels of Elizabeth Gaskell, we can see the problems of masters and how they treat their workers. Particularly in the North and South, the novel, or in Ruth, the novel Ruth, the unconsciousness and the escape from middle class identity was detailedly expressed. And the upper class ignorance can be seen in Elizabeth Gaskell's novel. And the workers' condition, the working condition in industry, again the death of children in England, which was completely forbidden, which was completely not shown or dealt. I mean, nobody, no writer or no one spoke about the death of children in England due to the industrial system. These are all shown in the novels of Elizabeth Gaskell. The one important thing about The Dark Knight's work, which was published as a serial in Charles Dickens magazine all the year round, it was actually a knight's work. The original title was A Knight's Work. It was Dickens who suggested the word Dark Knight. After reading the manuscripts, Dickens thought adding the word dark would give a great impact, or would give a great projection to the novel, A Dark Knight's Work. Then the Wives and Daughters, an everyday story, was a very common story, Wives and Daughters. The last section of the novel was written by Frederick Greenwood, the other writer. And Wives and Daughters deals with the an everyday story, like, and what happens with the common middle class family in Victorian society, how they lived. For example, the husband may be from a family, he would be doing a family work, but he was forced to work in industry. And the wife again, the wife again was not permitted to work, the children were forbidden a good education. So these kind of, now they suffer for their daily food, and how they manage to keep their family settlements during festival times or during the feast times. So these type of common men story, common life story was dealt in Wives and Daughters. Then the next writer is Anthony Trollope. Anthony Trollope was a novelist and a civil servant in Victorian time, and his novels revolve around social, political and gender issues commonly. His Chronicles of Bastardshire was set in a fictional England, fictional country like Bastardshire, and its cathedral town Barcester. There is two names, Barcestershire and Barcester. You must remember this. And it deals with the clergy and gentry and their social behavior, clergy and gentry social behavior, it particularly deals. It is a collection of six novels actually. The sixth one was the favorite of Anthony Trollope himself, the Barset and his, the last novel is The Last Chronicle of Barsets. It was the title of the novel. The other novel, first novel, The Three Clerks, was his own experience when he was a junior clerk in General Post Office. And there are three clerks. Let me tell the names of three clerks. The first clerk is Harry Norman. The second clerk is Larry Tudor. The third clerk is Larry Tudor's cousin, Charlie. I shall repeat: Harry Norman, Larry Tudor, and Larry Tudor's cousin, Charlie. These are the three clerks in the Three Clerks novel. And it is actually considered like that he had his own experience. He had shared his own experience when he was a junior clerk in General Post Office. And most of the sequences in the Three Clerks were the autobiography. Like the early form, an important novel of Anthony Trollope, which actually showed a condition of people who lived in farms. Then The Warden, again, it was the first book of Anthony Trollope, the first series of the Basister novels, The Warden. Then the next writer is George Meredith. George Meredith was nominated for Nobel Prize for 7 times. An important point that is, he was nominated for Nobel Prize for 7 times. And his novel, The Ordeal of Richard Feverel, A History of Father and Son, the other title. It can be seen as a novel of human strife between good and evil, both of which are mixed in the soul of every human being, actually. It is a true tragedy, the novel Ordeal of Richard Feverel. Sometimes it can be it can be seen as how we deal the good and bad things in our life, and that is easily can be captured in the novel. How the Victorian people, they managed with their good and evil. I hope you can understand. The industry or the industrialized society had made many changes in the minds of people that created so many temptations, that has given so many temptations to people, and that created so many evil things in their mind, though they be good with their religious attitudes, and they may be good with their moral attitudes. But the remarkable change of the industrialized society had given so many things, so many offerings to people, and they had created so many evil things in their mind. So that is beautifully dealt in the novel The Ordeal of Richard Feverel. Then Meredith is best known for his novel The Egoist. It is a tragic comical novel, and this novel was called the turning point in his life because that helps him to shine on stage afterwards. And this novel dramatizes the difficulty of being a woman in Victorian society, when women's bodies and minds are usually trafficked between fathers and husbands, the male bonds over women. So all these can be seen in George Meredith's The Egoist. Then the most liked authors of all time, Lewis Carroll, who was considered to be one of the great writers of children writing, children fiction. Lewis Carroll's Alice Adventures in Wonderland is a story of a young girl named Alice who falls through a rabbit hole into a fantasy world that was populated by the anthropomorphic creatures. The anthropomorphic creatures, like, they are the human traits, which was like the fear or the usual emotions. Like, the interesting fact about this work is it is one of the best examples of literary nonsense genre. There is a genre in literature like literary nonsense genre. So this is one of the best novels, or the best examples of literary nonsense genre. And this novel is translated into 97 languages, Alice Adventures in Wonderland. Then there is a sequel to Alice Adventures in Wonderland, that is the second one, Through the Looking Glass and What Alice Found There. And this is again the same story of the same character Alice again, who enters a fantasy world. This time Alice climbs up with a mirror in her hand, that she can see beyond time. So all her novels, The Hunting of Snack, The Tangled Tale, or Sylvian Bruno, all these novels are children fiction. In a way, I'll tell you this, the politics behind children fiction later on. I will finish all those writers first. We may lost the sequence then. Then the other important writer is Robert Ballantyne, who was a Scottish juvenile fiction writer. He was a Scottish juvenile fiction writer. The Coral Island, the first novel, Coral Island, another title is A Tale of the Pacific Ocean. In this novel, there are three boys who survive in a shipwreck in a South Pacific island, and how they escape from the island is the story of the Coral Island. I think it should remind you of the two important writers. One is Daniel Defoe and William Golding, right? Because the similar story, like William Golding's The Lord of the Flies, have a similar story where some young boys are left in an island, unknown island. How they escape from the island is the story of Lord of the Flies. The similar story is The Coral Island, A Tale of Pacific Ocean. Again, the sequel, The Gorilla Hunters, A Tale of Wilds of Africa. The same boys will be in the Gorilla Hunters. The Pirate City and The Eagle Cliff, all these type of, I mean, all these novels of Ballantyne are adventurous novel like. It is a typical Robinsonade type of novel. Robinsonade, you might be aware of it. Robinsonade is a fictional type of Robinson Crusoe novel by Daniel Defoe. So Ballantyne was a pure adventurous novelist. The other novelist is Anna Sewell. She is famous for only one novel, Black Beauty. The other title is, the full title is Black Beauty, His Grooms and Companions, The Autobiography of Oz. It is a very beautiful novel. I would recommend you to read this novel first. If you want to learn how to treat people with kindness, sympathy and respect, you must read this novel, Black Beauty. And it is a very simple story. It is a story narrated as an autobiographical element by a horse named Black Beauty. There is a horse, that's name. The name of horse is Black Beauty. And the horse is narrating a story as an autobiography, beginning with this the 3 days as a colt on a farm with his mother, to his different life in pulling cabs in London during its youth days, and unto his happy retirement in the country. So it is a very beautiful descriptive novel, Black Beauty. So that gives a kind of advice to the people, advice to the learned people, how to treat the other men, other fellow human being, with kindness, sympathy and respect. Then Anthony Hope, the other important writer in Victorian era. Anthony Hope is known for his adventurous novel like Ballantyne and other novelists. The Prisoner of Zenda is an adventurous novel. It is a story of a king of Ruritania. Ruritania, it is a fictional country. It was a story of the king of Ruritania who was drugged before on the eve of his coronation, so that he won't be coming for the coronation ceremony. And it is a detailed, it is a kind of not pure adventurous novel. It also satirizes the political condition of Victorian England, the political condition during Victorian era all over. Then the sequel is Rupert of Henso. It is serialized in the Pall Mall magazine and in other magazine, Macross magazine, from 1897 to 1898. The same characters who were in Prisoner of Zenda will be there in Rupert of Henso, but the story is completely different. Then the most celebrated novelist of Victorian times, after Dickens and Hardy, that is Robert Louis Stevenson, R.L. Stevenson, who is famous for his novel Treasure Island. Before that, we must see something about The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. It is a Gothic novella. It is not a novel, it is a Gothic novella. It is about a London advocate. The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde is a story about a London advocate named Gabriel John, who investigates the strange occurrences between his old friend Dr. Jekyll and the evil Mr. Hyde. Dr. Jekyll is the friend of the advocate Gabriel John, and he is investigating the strange occurrences between these two, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. We still use the phrase, right, Jekyll and Hyde. Jekyll and Hyde we used in our daily speech to mean the good and bad, and this comes from this novel, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Then Treasure Island, you all know about this novel. It is an adventurous novel serialized in Children Magazine. And in when it was serialized, the title was Treasure Island or the Mutiny of Hispaniola. That was the title. Later, when it's published as a novel, the novel titled as Treasure Island. Then Kidnapped is another historical fiction, also an adventurous novel by Stevenson. That was first published in the magazine Young Folks from May to July 1986. So Stevenson is again another adventurous novel, adventure novelist. Let me tell you the politics behind that later. Then the other novels like The Black Arrow, The Tale of Two Roses, it was again a historical adventure novel and a romance novel sometimes. It first appeared in as a serial in with a subtitle A Tale of Tunstall Forest. The final novel of Stevenson is Ware of Hemiston. It was unfinished. That was set during Napoleonic Wars. So he was the third writer who was writing about Napoleonic Wars. And the other novelist, Thomas Hughes, is famous for his semi-autobiographical novel Tom Brown's School Days, which was published under the titles Tom Brown at Rugby, Rugby School Days at Rugby, and Tom Brown's School Days at Rugby in 1857. These are the other titles of Tom Brown's School Days. The story is set in a rugby school where he had his primary education, where he had his education in the rugby school. Then the sequel to it is Tom Brown at Oxford, and that was again a semi-autobiographical story. Tom Brown, it was set at St. Ambrose College, Oxford. That was a fictional setting, there was no college like St. Ambrose College. Tom Brown, Oxford is a sequel to Tom Brown's School Days. Both are semi-autobiographical of Thomas Hughes. Then Rudyard Kipling, an Indian-born British writer, was a Nobel laureate. His book Kim had won the Nobel Prize. But earlier I told about the Great Game, a political combat between Russia and Britain over the Central Asia's rule. So the term Great Game became popular. Actually, Rudyard Kipling introduced the term, the Great Game. So the Great Game, the term or the whole event became popular only after the publication of this novel, Kim. He was a Nobel Prize winner, and he unfolds the story of the Great Game, the political combat between Russia and Britain. Then he is also known for his famous collection of stories like Jungle Book. I think everybody would have seen the movie Jungle Book even. He is still remembered for it. Then Samuel Butler, who's known for his utopian satirical novel, Airborne. Airborne is an utopian satirical novel, which was set in a fictional country discovered by the protagonist. It was a pure satire on Victorian society. Airborne is a pure satire on Victorian society. Being an utopian satirical novel, it satirized the whole Victorian society. How people suffered, or how the rich people, or how people who own the industry, how they lived, or how people who worked in industry, how they lived. So all these are detailedly described in Airborne, the novel. The other title is Over the Range. Then the other novel, Airborne, revisited 20 years later, both by original discoverer of the country and by his son. It is a sequel to Airborne, published in 1901, with a completely different idea of Victorian society. Both the novels had different set of themes. In a way, both express the Victorian society, but with different ideas and different themes. And The Way of All Flesh is a Bildungsroman novel, also considered as a semi-autobiographical. Then the important writer, Wilkie Collins, who is known for his mystery novels, and who is also known for his novel Moonstone, who was also a playwright. Then Moonstone, the first detective novel of English history. It is the best British epistolary novel, Moonstone. It has established many ground rules for the detective novels. He was the one who started writing detective novels, who gave a kind of rules, a set of rules to the detective novelist thereafter. Moonstone, as you know, it is a diamond. Its name came from Hindu god of moon, Chandra. So it is a complete detective. I think you must have read this novel. I remember the days of my UG days in UG in St. Xavier's when Dr. Ignatius he taught us the novel The Moonstone. So I can remember the story now. Then it is a very important novel. Then Woman in White, other important novel of Wilkie Collins, which was considered to be among the first mystery novels and is widely regarded as one of the first in the genre of sensation novels in a way. But Moonstone has a more influence than Woman in White, because after Moonstone, the detective novel series started. There started many detective novels. Then the other novelist, R.D. Blackmore, Richard Doddridge Blackmore, he was famous in the second half of Victorian times. Perhaps he is very famous for his the style, his peculiar style, his personification of the countryside, how Hardy personified the society, Victorian England. So Richard Blackmore was famous for his personification of countryside. Often he is referred as the last Victorian. R.D. Blackmore was referred as the last Victorian. You remember this point. His novel Lorna Doone, A Romance of Exmoor, the subtitle is Romance of Exmoor, Lorna Doone. It is a romance based novel. The romance is based on a group of historical characters. It is a very important novel of R.D. Blackmore, Lorna Doone. It is a romance, but since it based on a group of historical characters, including King Charles II, the Duke of Monmouth, and King James, and they are all characters in the novel Lorna Doone. He also mentioned the events of the Battle of Sedgemoor. All these kind of historical incidents were mentioned in Lorna Doone, but it is a pure romance. Then George Moore, who is famous for his single novel Esther Waters. He was an Irish novelist. A naturalistic writer is. One best novel is Esther Waters. It is a novel about a young pious woman, Esther, named Esther, from a poor working class family, and how she lives with the conditions that she had. It is a true depiction of fallen women during Victorian time. Though it was published at the end of the 19th century, it happens to tell the story of the fallen women throughout the 19th century. Then we must talk about Oscar Wilde sometimes, with this picture of Dorian Gray, which was a Gothic and philosophical novel. Oscar Wilde, you all know that he is the one who led the Art for Art's Sake group, the movement, along with Walter Pater. And this novel, Picture of Dorian Gray, is a Gothic, also a philosophical novel. And finally, we have Charlotte Ng, who wrote for the Service of Church particularly. All these three novels were written for the service of church. And Young's novel, usually they helped to spread the influence of Oxford movement actually. The Hair of Redcliffe is a pure depiction of Oxford movement. She usually write for the spread of Oxford movement or the service of church in her time. So with that we complete the novels and novelists of Victorian time. I think I have given you an introduction or an overall understanding or overall view of Victorian novels and novelists. See, when industrial revolution made people gather in one place, what happened was people started learning new things. One thing, they started communicating things orally first, and they have shared their cultural experiences, their social experiences to other community people, and the industries made it very easier. So what happened was people started learning other community ideas, other communal ideas first. So the spread of the science, the evolution of science, was easily spread among people. So in a way, what the monarch or what government thought, would have thought, was if their concentration is put towards something else, they may have limited questions, or people may stop asking questions, particularly the youth set, particularly the people who are in age group from 15 to 25, they are the maximum converts from the Anglican church to non-conformist, or again they return back to Roman Catholics, or sometimes they become agnostics, atheists, and they started following Darwin and Darwin's theory and all. So these type of adventurous novels and these type of the children fiction, what it made was it stopped people to ask questions against science and religion. So that was the main cause for projecting the adventurous fictional writers most during Victorian era. Thank you so much for listening to me, and all the very best for your net preparation. Thank you very much.